Monsters is a YouTube channel about the worst human beings on the planet. The episodes of this podcast deal with murder, dismemberment, torture, rape, child abuse, and mental illness. Please turn back while you still can. Viewer discretion is advised. If you want to read more stories about the worst people on the planet, or find ways to support the show, you can visit our blog at thisismonsters.com. Most people go to the doctor to make them healthy and prolong their life. Unfortunately, some doctors have used their position to hurt or even kill people. Here are five of the world's deadliest doctors. 1. Christopher Duntsch. This is one of the few cases where it's unclear whether or not a doctor was causing harm on purpose. Christopher Duntsch was a spine surgeon who was allowed to perform surgeries despite having very poor training. Over the course of 3 years, his surgeries resulted in 31 patients paralyzed or injured, and 2 dead. He had trouble in medical school with performing surgeries while under the influence, and was sent to an impaired physicians program. After that, he completed his residency after performing less than 100 surgeries, when a typical surgical resident performs more than 1,000 surgeries. When he moved to Texas to work at Baylor Scott & White Medical Center in Plano, Texas, commonly called Baylor Plano, he boasted about his abilities despite having extremely poor skills. His friends and family described him as being very stubborn about his own limitations, which leads them to believe that he thought he actually was a really great surgeon. The reality was that he was not. In his few years at Baylor Plano, he maimed several patients. He severed a major artery in one patient, which caused her to bleed to death. He performed spinal surgery on one of his own friends, Jerry Summers, where he penetrated an artery and left his friend paralyzed from the neck down. Then he killed another patient when he cut a major blood vessel during surgery, which caused the patient to bleed out. In 2012, he was forced to resign from Baylor Plano and was given temporary surgical privileges at Dallas Medical Center. Within days, he had killed another patient and caused permanent damage to another when he installed metal hardware meant to be attached to bone into muscle. Another surgery, he punctured an artery, cut the vocal cords, and left a hole in the patient's esophagus before closing them up with a sponge left inside of them. He was fired from Dallas Medical Center and his license was revoked by the Texas State Medical Board. He was charged with 6 felony counts of aggravated assault with a deadly weapon, surgical tools, 5 counts of aggravated assault causing serious bodily injury, and 1 count of injury to a child, elderly, or disabled person. While on trial, Duntsch's lawyer argued that he didn't know he'd done a bad job in regards to his surgeries. He claimed he only found out in court, which, if true, means he's the most incompetent doctor, if not person, on Earth. He was found guilty and sentenced to life in prison. He will be eligible for parole in 2045. He will be 74. 2. Harold Shipman. Harold Shipman was a general practitioner in the town of Hyde in Manchester, England. He developed a thriving practice through the 80s and 90s. He worked at a couple of different group practices before starting his own practice. He became a well-respected part of the community, and many people trusted him to care for their elderly family members. In 1998, a series of instances brought some disturbing facts to light about Shipman. The owner of a funeral home had made a complaint about the alarming amount of elderly females who were being sent to him for cremation from Shipman. The police were notified, but no evidence could be found of foul play. A few months later, 81-year-old Kathleen Grundy was found dead in her home following a visit from Shipman. It was revealed that a will had been created that left £386,000 to Shipman, and her family suspected that the will was not authentic. This time, when the police were involved, they were able to exhume Grundy's body and find evidence that she was injected with diamorphine, heroin. It was uncovered that Shipman had killed the woman and forged the will. Authorities were able to uncover 15 other deaths that followed a similar pattern and hadn't been cremated. Shipman recommended cremation to the families of his victims, so future investigations regarding cause of death would be impossible. In January of 2000, Harold Shipman was found guilty of 15 counts of murder and 1 count of forgery. He was given a life sentence for each count of murder and 4 years for forgery. They only tried him for the murder of the victims they could exhume, but a 2-year investigation estimated that he killed as many as 250 people. He hanged himself in his jail cell on January 13, 2004, just one day before his 58th birthday. 3. Michael Swango. During Michael Swango's time in medical school, he showed many signs of what he would become and gets a pretty bad reputation. It's when he leaves school that a very long list of medical transgressions begins. Despite a very poor report from the dean of his school, he manages to get an internship and residency at Ohio State University. Once there, a series of unexplained deaths occur. One woman survived and claimed Swango had injected her with something. He was moved to a different wing of the hospital, and unexplained deaths started happening there. He was let go from the residency program and got a job at an ambulance company. While working there, a pattern developed that anytime Swango brought in food or drink, the other EMTs would all get sick. This led to a police search of his home where authorities found drugs, arsenic, and syringes. He was convicted of poisoning and sentenced to 5 years in prison. When released, he lied on his application to get a job as a career counselor at a VA hospital where his coworkers started getting sick frequently. Then he worked as a lab technician where the same thing happened. Wanting to get back into medicine, but unable due to his felony record, he changed his name and applied for a residency program at University of South Dakota with all forged paperwork. His deception was discovered before any unexplained deaths happened. He then forged his way into a psychiatric residency at Stony Brook School of Medicine, where patients started mysteriously dying. When authorities started investigating, Swango moved to Zimbabwe, where he forged credentials to start working in a hospital there. Of course, patients started mysteriously dying there. Unfortunately for Swango, some of the patients survived their encounter with him, and when authorities searched his home, they found various drugs and poisons. When the heat was on in Zimbabwe, Swango was attempting to lie his way into a job in Saudi Arabia, but was caught while traveling there. He was immediately charged with fraud for lying about his background when he applied for a job at a VA hospital. Once he was in prison, they used the time to build a case against him for his other crimes. A week before he was released from prison, he was charged with 3 counts of murder and 1 count each of assault, false statements, and mail fraud. He was given the option to plead guilty and stay in prison, or be released and be extradited to Zimbabwe to face 5 counts of murder there. Needless to say, he pled guilty and was sentenced to life without the possibility of parole. He will die in prison. 4. Maxim Petrov. Maxim Petrov was an emergency doctor in St. Petersburg. Not much is available about his past or training, but it seemed that he worked at a local health center and would target patients from there for burglary. In 1997, he started burglarizing elderly patients by showing up at their house when their relatives were away. He would take their blood pressure, claim that it was high, and give them an injection. The injection would knock them out, and he would go about the house stealing jewelry and valuables. At first, his victims weren't killed. They just woke up after he had left. In February of 1999, during his 13th robbery, he had already drugged his patient and was in the process of burglarizing their house when the patient's daughter arrived home. He stabbed the daughter with a screwdriver and then strangled the unconscious patient. From that point on, Petrov would use a lethal cocktail of drugs to kill the patient, steal their possessions, and then set the house on fire to destroy the evidence. It took the police a year to discover that the relationship between the victims was that they were all lung patients of the medical center where Petrov worked. They made a list of potential future victims and arrested Petrov as he arrived at one of their homes on January 17, 2000. Once arrested, he confessed to the murders but recanted a few months later. A search of his home turned up various stolen possessions from the victims. He was found guilty of 12 murders and sentenced to life. He will die in prison. 5. Walter Freeman. Walter Freeman came from a family of doctors. His father was a successful doctor, and his grandfather was a well-known surgeon in the Civil War. Freeman went to medical school where he studied neurology. He eventually moved to Washington, D.C., where he became the city's first neurologist, working at George Washington University. He took a procedure performed in Portugal, modified it, and renamed it the lobotomy. This procedure was intended to cure mental illness by going into the brain and severing connections between the frontal lobes and the thalamus. Freeman had already lost his surgical license since he killed his last patient during surgery, so he found a surgeon to start performing the lobotomies under his direction. After 10 years of performing the procedure in tandem with a surgeon, Freeman developed a way to perform a lobotomy by going through the orbital socket. This did not require a surgeon and could be performed all over the country by almost anyone in 10 minutes. He called it a transorbital lobotomy. It's been noted that Freeman developed a reckless enthusiasm for the procedure. Traveling the country to demonstrate it, he regularly dismissed sterilization procedures and chewed gum during the process. The procedure had a 14% fatality rate, with many subjects dying of cerebral hemorrhage during the process. He performed 3,439 lobotomies in his lifetime, which leaves a death toll of approximately 480. This doesn't take into account the patients who ended up crippled for life, from having disabled mental functions to being in a complete vegetative state. Freeman was never punished for the deaths he caused because performing lobotomies was legal at the time. In 1952, he retired from George Washington University and started his own small practice in California. He was banned from performing lobotomies in 1967 after a patient died while he was performing a third lobotomy on her. That was the last lobotomy performed in the United States, as the procedure started losing popularity in the 1950s. Walter Freeman died due to complications of surgery on May 31st, 1972. If you like these videos, please hit subscribe, click like, or leave me a comment. If you'd like to support the channel, you can donate a few bucks through Buy Me a Coffee. You can click the link within the YouTube banner or go to buymeacoffee.com/monsters. Another way you can support the channel is by using our Amazon link anytime you're going to buy something at Amazon. You can go to our website at thisismonsters.com and click through the Amazon banner. Anytime you're already going to buy something from Amazon, you can click through that link and buy your items at no additional charge, and we get a small commission. I'm always working to provide more content at better quality, and your support helps me do that. I thank you in advance.